I've worked as a lawyer, as an editor, a river guide, among other things. For the last 8 years or so, I've been really kind of steeped in water law and policy issues. But I've been fascinated by water for a lot longer, and also by how we use natural resources and how we shape generally rules and laws and institutions, and they end up then shaping how we live. So the talk is called Arizona Water Law 101, and I suspect that for some of you it may be a ton of new information, and for others mostly a retelling of stories you're familiar with, but hopefully you can still enjoy sitting back and thinking about things from the big picture point of view. I'll try to keep it simple but still accurate. We'll see. And starting with this picture, satellite view of Arizona, because some people talk about, you know, the 30,000 foot view of things. We're going to go for the 400 mile view of things, which is how far above the Earth a Landsat satellite is when it takes pictures such as this. I learned from Google. Thinking about that sort of really big picture perspective, I also wanted to tell you a little story, which I think a few of you have heard me tell. But when I was lucky enough to get to work as a river guide in the Grand Canyon, one of the perks was that at one point I got to fly up in a helicopter over the canyon. And it was, as you can imagine, dramatic and striking and beautiful. And it also, it gave you that big picture perspective. And looking down, I found myself thinking both about the forces that shape the canyon, sun creating, precipitation cycles, plate tectonics, gravity moving water downhill, erosion. But then as we were taking off and landing, you could also see where the trees around the canyon started and where sort of the rest of the world ended. And it made me think about the other forces that shape our world, which are really the choices we make as a society that then get manifested in laws. Somebody a long time ago decided that we're going to have a category of things called national forests, and we're going to have a category of things called national parks, and then we're going to make the Grand Canyon one of those and part of the other. and that was defining the boundary that I was looking down and seeing below me, that you can almost see there, the green along the canyon up in the corner there. So I also wanted to put this picture here to start talking about Arizona water law by talking about Arizona water and Arizona. And for those of you who aren't familiar, I'll kind of walk over and do this. So the three regions that you think of in Arizona. First, so this is the Grand Canyon cut by the Colorado River coming through here. Here's the edge of the Colorado Plateau. Here's basin and range, so mountain ranges and flat areas in between down the southern part of the state. And then here's the transitional zone, which is the mountainous area between the two, where we are now, of course, probably there-ish. So we're going to go through a little bit of sort of big picture context about Arizona water first. Arizona, it's rugged, we just saw. We also know it's hot. We know it's dry. This map shows annual average precipitation from the U.S. from 1990 to 2009. The light green areas are about 30 inches of rain a year. The purple up in the northwest is about 180 inches of rain a year. And the darkest red, which you can see, for example, down in the corner of Arizona near Yuma, is less than 5 inches per year. Average annual rainfall in Arizona is about 3 inches in Yuma and over 36 inches in a few areas of higher elevation along the Mogollon Rim that I showed you, that border along the edge of the Colorado Plateau, and in the White Mountains. Another kind of basic fact about Arizona, It's grown really rapidly, really recently. Population really took off after World War II, made possible not only by the air conditioning that became more widespread, but the new technology that allowed us to start pumping water out of the ground with greater efficiency. So Arizona is also incredibly urban. The population is concentrated in the Phoenix-Tucson corridor, although there are also fast-growing areas outside of that corridor. I've actually just read that the West in general is a highly urban place, even though that's not how we always think of it. It's a state with great cultural diversity. Not only is there that difference between urban populations and those in smaller towns and other kinds of living in this state, but there are 22 federally recognized Indian tribes in Arizona. It's a state with great natural diversity, and this is in part because of the huge range in elevations in this state, ranging from near sea level near Yuma up to almost 13,000 feet in the San Francisco peaks outside of Flagstaff. And in part because of this range in topography, Arizona has been found to be, by at least one study, the third most biologically diverse state in the country. It's the most diverse state without a coastline. These are some shots showing the diversity of landscapes that comes in part from that, that contributes to the biological diversity, sorry. So Arizona is in the Colorado River Basin, which is the same thing as a watershed, meaning all of the Colorado River's water gets produced in the basin, which is everything within that white line there. The basin includes parts of 7 US states, 2 Mexican states. And Arizona is unique because almost all of the state, if you look at it, is in the Colorado River Basin. It makes up almost half of the basin. So we're uniquely reliant on this system. Almost all of Arizona's rivers and streams flow, or at least used to flow, into the Colorado River. Not all do because a good portion of Arizona's rivers no longer have water in them, which is something we'll get to later. So what's the water that's available to us in this hot, dry, mostly urban, and newly populous state? There are 4 different categories of water supplies in Arizona, and there are different laws and policies that govern each kind of supply. The 2 largest sources of supply are Colorado River water and groundwater. We also get some water from what we call in-state rivers and a smaller but significant chunk from effluent, which is treated wastewater. So Colorado River water versus in-state, we just said that they're all part of the same watershed and part of the same system. But legally, the main stem of the Colorado River is treated differently from the tributaries or the rivers that flow into it. So this is the main... I guess I don't have that there. This is the main stem starting right up here. Colorado River is dammed right as it enters the state. Glen Canyon Dam creates Lake Powell, which backs up into Utah. And then below the dam, the river flows about 277 miles through the Grand Canyon. Here's a shot of the river in the Grand Canyon. The river, there I show it, the canyon stretches from Lake Powell to Lake Mead. Lake Mead is a reservoir created by Hoover Dam. That's Nevada on the left, Arizona on the right. Las Vegas gets its water from Lake Mead. Then if you move south, in this stretch that I show here, there are about 4 more significant dams. Have a pointer. That stretch. There are about 4 more significant dams, including right where you see on this map, unmarked river. I'll use my pointer here. That's the Bill Williams River. Right near there is Parker Dam forming Lake Havasu. The Central Arizona Project Canal takes water for about 300 miles from there, uphill from to the Phoenix and Tucson areas. There's a shot of the CAP Canal. A little bit more than half of Arizona's Colorado River water goes through the CAP Canal. The rest is used by towns, farms, Indian tribes, and other users right along the river. So we said the Colorado River makes up about 40% of Arizona's supply, and the next category we'll talk about is in-state rivers, or the tributaries. About 16% of Arizona's supply comes from these rivers. You can look at them here. Again, note that not all of them shown as rivers here actually have water in them along their entire length. Almost half of our in-state water comes from the Salt River watershed, which also includes the Verde. It's the highlighted areas there, roughly. The rest comes from the Gila and other rivers like the Little Colorado and the Bill Williams. Next, groundwater. Groundwater is water below ground. It originally came from rain or snow and flowed down between cracks in the rocks or in the spaces between gravel or soil, as in these pictures. It's stored underground. It often is moving a little bit as it's pulled by gravity and pushed by pressure and steered by the cracks between things. Arizona has an amazingly large supply of water underground. A lot of it has been there for a long time, centuries in some cases. And we've been using it in some parts of the state for a long time, and now at this point, in some parts of the state, faster than it's being replenished, something else that we'll come back to. You call an area underground where water is stored an aquifer. Finally, that last category is effluent. Effluent's another name for treated wastewater. It's legally considered a separate category of water, but physically, of course, you first have to get the water from one of those other sources, then use it, then treat it, and then it's called effluent. So it's not a new source of water, it's a name for water that's being reused. And it's actually not the sum total of water being reused in a certain sense. It's water that's reused before it's put back in a river. Once it gets put back in the river, it gets called surface water again. So, for example, the water that we're drinking down in Phoenix that came from the Colorado River water has been reused and reused and reused by the time we get it. That's where Arizona's water comes from. Where does it go? About 70% to agriculture, which is something that that I can tell you based on polling information most people don't know. The industrial category there is industry that it has its own water supply. There's also light industry and sort of commercial uses in the municipal use category. So to understand how the law works, we not only have to know these categories, but we have to go back in time. Not the 2 billion years that I was thinking about when I was up in that helicopter, which is how long ago the basement rocks and the canyon were formed. Not even the dawn of humanity or a few thousand years ago when ancient Puebloans were managing water in this area using things like check dams. Or the Hohokam in the Phoenix area were digging hundreds of miles of irrigation canals. Or even to when the Spanish first showed up in Arizona. Although some of these things did leave a mark on our water management. But we're going to go a relatively short way back, really, to when early Americans, as in early U.S. citizens, not the people who were here before that, were first starting to come west. In Arizona, that's not until the startlingly late date of 1825, when the first American explorers entered Arizona, trapping beaver along the upper Gila. When miners and settlers first came to the West, there was no clear law governing water use. And the law for the East, where there was a lot more precipitation, wouldn't work well to address Western issues, mostly because in the East, crops didn't need to be irrigated for the most part. They were watered by rain. And there were enough streams and rivers that access to them for small amounts of water was easy. Here, miners needed to take water out of the streams to use in the mining process, and farmers needed to take it out of the stream to irrigate crops. So the system or custom that evolved was essentially a first-come, first-served system. Whoever takes water out of the river first gets a continuing right to use that same amount of water for the same purpose the next year. The next person who comes along gets access to what's left over. So it's a system of seniority. The system is called prior appropriation. As in most of the West, the customary system was affirmed by Arizona's territorial courts and legislature and even in the Constitution, and it's still essentially the law of the land. So surface water is governed by prior appropriation. First in time, first in right, there's a beneficial use and diversion requirement, so you have to put the water to a beneficial use on a particular piece of land. You need to divert the water out of the stream. You can't, at least traditionally. And so historically, it was a law for taking water out of the stream. And when it was developed, there was no sort of fixed stopping point where you said, OK, that's enough for the river to keep being a river. And in fact, the system ends up in some ways working as an incentive to take as much water out of the system as you can, as soon as you can, and for as long as you can, when you look at things kind of over a long period of time. The system has changed over the years in terms of who you need to notify that you're taking water out of the stream and appropriating it, making keeping track of the rights very complicated, something else we'll get to later. Back in the era of Jack Swilling, the founder of Phoenix, when he was appropriating water for what ended up becoming part of the Salt River Project, he diverted water and recorded it with the county. Before that, you could post something basically on a tree. Now you file with the Department of Water Resources. The Salt River Project, holder of some very senior rights, began as a communal effort to dig irrigation ditches to irrigate crops in central Arizona, and eventually became one of the first United States Bureau of Reclamation projects. It includes systems of dams on the Salt and Verde Rivers and canals to distribute the water that SRP has rights to its shareholders in the Phoenix area. This is just a shot that shows construction of the Roosevelt Dam in the early 1900s. That's Roosevelt Dam now. So overall, this is how surface water, water in rivers and streams, was treated and still is under a first-come, first-served system. In the meantime, starting early in US history, people also got water from underground. Access to rivers wasn't easy. They didn't always flow year-round, and their whole flow can be pretty readily used up. So native people, early Europeans, and early Americans often relied on springs where water flows naturally from underground. They also dug simple wells using a bucket and a rope to access the water. This photo is actually from New Mexico, and it shows a well that's being powered by burros. It was a big technological development when people first started to be able to use windmills to bring water up from out of ground. And then that was followed by a steam pump. I was reading about one well in the Tucson area that was kept running using just vast quantities of mesquite down in that area. Legally, groundwater was treated separately from surface water. So there weren't statutes. It wasn't mentioned in the Constitution specifically, but it was governed by the groundwater use was governed by the court system early on in Arizona. And the court-administered system that evolved in Arizona and actually in most of the West is essentially a help-yourself system. If you own land, you can drill a well on that land and use whatever groundwater that well can pump. And when I've told this story before, I've sometimes said that it probably wasn't obvious to people at the time that because groundwater and surface water often actually are connected, that there might be issues where people were using the same water sort of from different access points. Although just recently I was reading about some conflicts going way back, like into the 1600s, where people were worried about one kind of water use affecting the other. So maybe that story isn't quite as facile as the way I've been telling it. At any rate, for whatever reason, legally, groundwater was still treated as a separate resource, which is another thing that we'll come back to. So groundwater today is governed in much of the state, outside of the active management areas, by the doctrine of reasonable use. If you're a landowner and you're pumping groundwater, you can pump as much as you can put to reasonable use. And that reasonable requirement has not really ever been used to limit someone's pumping. There are restrictions on transporting groundwater after you've pumped it. So if we think about Arizona right around time of statehood in 1912 and a little after, this is about how surface water and groundwater were being governed. Let's turn our thoughts now to the Colorado River, which is different because it's an interstate river. So early Americans saw the Colorado River as a huge asset, and early on when these states had just become states, there was a lot of worry among people who wanted to see the western states grow about how the river would be treated legally. For the most part, individual states were controlling how water was used, and for the most part, they used prior appropriation. But the Colorado River is a multi-state river, and the states lower down on the river, especially California, were growing much faster than the states upstream. So states like Colorado worried that if the system of seniority was used on the Colorado River as a whole and between states, California and Arizona might claim all of the river's water before upstream states had a chance to put any to use. At the same time, California worried that Colorado and the other upstream states might just capture the water before it flowed down to them and argue that where the water originated is where the rights should be, which was what we were arguing with Mexico in some instances, except for on the Rio Grande where it was reversed. Given this legal uncertainty, it was difficult to finance the large projects that were seen as necessary to develop the West. So all of the Colorado River states had an interest in achieving some certainty about water rights on the Colorado River, and they didn't want to let the federal government decide. So they came together and negotiated the Colorado River Compact of 1922, which divides the water in the Colorado River between the upper basin states and the lower basin states. You can actually see right there is the line between the basins. Which distracted me. Where am I? So when they negotiated the compact, there were a few issues that were left out which have come back to haunt us or to need addressing in the future. For example, they were wrong about the amount of water that there was to divide up. Tribes in Mexico weren't really incorporated into the thinking for the most part, nor were the fish or the health of the river itself. Nonetheless, fast forward to today, and that compact is still at the heart of how the river's water is managed. Federal law and Supreme Court decree divide the lower basin's water among the lower basin states. An additional compact divides the upper basin's water among those states. A treaty with Mexico governs the sharing of water between the two countries, and a whole host of other law governs many of the details. Altogether, it's often called the law of the river. Under the law of the river, Arizona has a right to 2.8 million acre-feet of water from the main stem of the Colorado. And as the law has been interpreted so far, it also gets to use all of the water in the in-state tributaries, which are considered separate, although some people would say that there's still a little bit of legal uncertainty about this. Arizona at first didn't sign the Colorado River Compact, but in the 1940s and 1950s, as you saw before, the state really began to grow and the river was increasingly being developed. A treaty with Mexico was signed, and Arizonans worried if they didn't sign the compact, they wouldn't be able to put their water to use, and if they didn't put it to use, they might lose out on the water allocated to the state. Leaders had been long clamoring for a canal to bring water from the Colorado River into the central part of the state. So in 1944, Arizona signed the compact. Almost 25 years later, the Colorado River Basin Project Act was signed, authorizing construction of the CAP Canal. Construction began in 1973 and was finished 20 years later, south of Tucson. And this ties, again, back into the groundwater story. As Arizona had been growing, and with the advent of the deep turbine pump, which was the latest groundwater technology, this came along right around when Arizona's population was also starting to surge. Phoenix and Tucson had been significantly drawing down the large aquifers under the central part of the state. Leaders in the state wanted to see this issue addressed, and the federal government also essentially gave the state an ultimatum, insisting that Arizona do something to take care of its unsustainable groundwater use if the federal government was going to continue to provide funding for the CAP canal. This led to the passage in 1980 of Arizona's Groundwater Management Act, which was hailed at the time as an innovation in state and local government. The act, we call it the GMA, created active management areas, which we call AMAs. There are now five of them. It's a little hard to see, but they're the pink areas here. And within these AMAs, groundwater use is much more strictly controlled than in the rest of the state, where groundwater pumping is still essentially unrestricted. And note that Arizona's rivers are largely outside of the areas here where pumping is being controlled. And actually, if you were to take a map that showed which parts of Arizona's rivers still have perennial or year-round flow in them and compare that, you'd find that Arizona's still flowing rivers really are mostly outside of the areas where groundwater use is being strictly controlled. Main features of the AMAs include grandfathered groundwater rights and withdrawal permits. There's no expansion of irrigation permitted within the AMAs. There are ratcheting management plans tied to management goals. You guys were talking about the fourth management plan in your meeting earlier. And there's an assured water supply program, which is also tied to management goals. The assured water supply program requires demonstration of a 100-year assured water supply for all new subdivisions. And I won't go into too many details here, but in order for something to be an assured water supply, it also has to be consistent with the management goal of the active management area. Well, I guess I will say it's different from the adequate water supply program, which exists outside of the AMAs, which operates essentially as a consumer protection standard so that developers of new subdivisions have to discover whether and communicate whether there's an adequate water supply as it's defined under the law before a new subdivision is built. But just because there's not an adequate water supply doesn't mean you can't develop the subdivision. So that's how things work in really broad strokes today. This is how the law stands. The Colorado River is governed by a federal law of the river. In-state surface water, the tributaries are governed by state prior appropriation. Groundwater in the active management areas by the Groundwater Management Act, and groundwater outside of the AMAs by the doctrine of reasonable use. So there are quite a few issues that remain for us to address today. I was at a conference earlier this year where former Senator Kyle gave a list of water issues that Arizona is facing, and it was quite a long list. But I think you can see it through the lens of two major challenges, which are things that the law wasn't originally set up to address: ensuring sustainable water supplies that last, and sustaining rivers that flow and contribute to our economy, well-being, and quality of life. So that's the positive version of sort of some goals for us to strive for. The more blunt version is that we're not meeting those goals today. We're living on borrowed water in many instances, water that's not going to keep sustaining itself over time. And we don't have a systematic way to protect the region's rivers. So I'm going to go through a few stories that kind of illustrate these challenges in different scenarios and explain how the law isn't set up to address those two things we talked about. So first, the Colorado River. In the basin as a whole, as I said, the allocations made to the states were made during a wet time in the basin, and early warnings of this fact were actually ignored. So it now turns out that the allocations add up to more than flows in the river in a given year. Allocations among the states are defined in terms of consumptive use. The water gets consumed, as in Nevada, which has a right to 300,000 acre feet, uses up 300,000 acre feet. It uses much more, but it depletes the river by 300,000 acre feet. Basin-wide, the compact plus the treaty with Mexico allocates 16.5 or 17.5, depending on how you look at it, million acre feet. And long-term reconstructed flow in the river is more like 15 million acre feet. And that's without considering future growth and use. Some of the states haven't grown into their allocations, or climate change projections. Lower basin allocations don't count system losses, including about 800,000 acre feet of reservoir losses at Lake Mead a year alone. So we're relying on extra water from the upper basin. Each year that the upper basin delivers to the lower basin the amount that by law it's required to deliver, Lake Mead actually drops. You need to have a year where more is delivered than what's required for Lake Mead to stay at the same level. So we're going through our reserves. In fact, it's now very official that in recent years, Colorado River use has exceeded the amount that is returned to the system in a given year, at least over sort of a rolling average, when you look at it as a rolling average. The Bureau of Reclamation has completed a first ever study of supply and demand in the Colorado River Basin. This is a figure from that. They've also projected these numbers going out into the future, and the study suggests, and they've concluded, that something's going to have to give or change. In the meantime, the Colorado River itself no longer reaches the sea. That's the Colorado River stream bed right before it crosses from the US into Mexico. And there's a vast area that used to be lush that's now dry. A huge area also that used to feed the community that lived there that no longer does. So throughout the Colorado River Basin, the health of rivers is in jeopardy. The law was originally set up to encourage taking water from rivers and streams, but there's no set stopping point to make sure that rivers continue to exist. It's slow from our perspective, but from that far back 400-mile perspective, it has been quick and recent that we are losing rivers at a landscape scale. In Arizona, more than a third of Arizona river stretches that once flowed year-round are now dry or intermittent. That's work that the Nature Conservancy did, I believe. The Gila and Salt Rivers that once coursed through Phoenix are in many sections only dry valleys. That's the Salt up on the top left. The Santa Cruz River used to support cottonwood and mesquite forests near Tucson and is now dry there for much of the year. And this slide is to remind us that a lot of this is outside of the active management areas where groundwater pumping is regulated. Groundwater pumping is a major threat to Arizona's remaining rivers. Scientists, also at TNC, have done a study showing that 7 more Arizona rivers, river stretches, could be dried up from pumping, municipal pumping that occurs in our lifetime if we don't do something to change the system. How much does this matter? We talked about how Arizona contains greater biodiversity than all but 2 other states. This vast variety of life depends on rivers in a desert. Arizona ranks first among states in the proportion of native freshwater fish species at risk of extinction. It's estimated that most of the state's threatened or endangered vertebrates rely directly on riverside habitat. Everything from coyotes and bobcats to seasonal migratory birds rely on riparian areas for drinking water, habitat, shade, and as migratory corridors through the desert and mountains as they travel through the region. And furthermore, rivers matter to Arizonans who have cherished them and enjoy them, and to the economies and cultures of rural areas in particular, and to the state's multi-billion-dollar tourism industry. a hard time seeing this fact I wrote down that I need to read here, but river-based recreation by Arizona residents alone has been calculated to generate $5.9 billion in annual economic activity. Half of Arizona's state parks and 20 of its 22 national parks, monuments, and similar sites include a river, stream, lake, or other water feature. This is a project that we did with a few other environmental groups when I worked at Environmental Defense Fund called Celebrating Arizona's Rivers, where we profiled a different river each month for a year. Just really short, simple profiles, but they're a good resource if you want to do some learning about Arizona's rivers. So we're going to move on to the next issue, Arizona's adjudications. So we talked about how surface water diversions are governed by that doctrine of first in time, first in right. But how do you know who was first? Especially when some people were putting notices on trees and then courthouses and then with the state. And you have to back up your right with an actual use of the water on the right land. Rights theoretically exist according to the doctrine of prior appropriation. They do, the rights exist, but they're a little bit of a mess, prompting the Arizona adjudications, which are massive court proceedings, to quantify and validate claims for Arizona water, for water rights. They've been ongoing since the 1970s, and as people point out, haven't yet adjudicated a right. In the meantime, there's little certainty around water rights and no mechanism for enforcement, or minimal mechanism for enforcement. And to put this in perspective, it's useful to know a little bit about other states. In Texas, where I went to law school, for example, the state's rivers were adjudicated completely, comprehensively in the 1960s. In Colorado, there are water courts around the state that govern water rights and resolve disputes among water users. And in many states, we water lawyers get jealous because they have databases where they can go and look up who has what water right. If you were buying a piece of property, you could look up what the water right is. And here there's still a lot of uncertainty. So Arizona's behind in this regard. And at the same time, neither the adjudication court nor the Department of Water Resources is adequately funded for the job. Sort of part two of the Arizona adjudications. One of the first questions being addressed there is the surface water versus groundwater question. The two are governed differently, but they in fact are often hydrologically connected physically. So I'm guessing that many of you here who've been thinking about the Verde know this story, but Arizona's law's answer to this is a fictitious category of water called subflow. Water that is determined to be more connected to the stream than not, based largely on the geological feature from which it comes. And the court's still determining exactly where that law line is drawn. So if you're in the subflow zone, your water is going to be treated as surface water under the doctrine of prior appropriation. And if you're pumping what's determined not to be subflow, then that use is governed by the groundwater doctrine. While we're drawing that line, in the meantime, people continue to drill wells that may be pumping subflow and that they may in the future be found to not have a senior right to. And other wells that will, there are other wells that are being drilled and used that will be treated as groundwater pumping under the law, despite the fact that they draw from the same aquifer as the subflow and the surface water. Another question that is being addressed is how to treat reserved rights, including those of tribes who are considered legally to have very senior rights to water, but in many cases don't have actual wet water to go with their paper rights. The subflow issue ties into the story of Arizona's groundwater use outside of the active management areas. As we talked about, outside of the AMAs and most of Arizona, you can drill a well and start pumping from it pretty much no matter what, even if it will interfere with your neighbor's well, if it will interfere with a surface water right, if it will drain a river dry, and even if the amount of water being pumped is not sustainable in the long term. It's not really good for anybody. And it's an issue that's of special relevance, of course, to the Verde River, because pumping throughout the area can affect flows in the river. There also remains developable land in areas where continued increases in pumping could pose a threat to the river. As you all well know, finding a way forward that allows the Verde area to continue to develop and prosper while protecting the things that make it a place worth living in and visiting is one of this region's pressing challenges. So this is the last one, issue number 5, AMA sustainability. Under the Groundwater Management Act, most of Arizona's active management areas were supposed to achieve safe yield, where water withdrawals are balanced with what is replaced to the aquifer by 2025. But currently none is projected to do that and stay that way. The Department of Water Resources has also stated, essentially, that it doesn't have the legal tools to make that happen. So let's return to these two main challenges that we started with, ensuring sustainable water supplies and sustaining rivers. You can see that the law was actually set up to do something quite different, allow for use of the resource, in some cases without limit, and in some cases within a framework that is no longer quite adequate. Yesterday's framework wasn't set up to meet today's challenges. So is there no hope? I think no, there is not no hope. If you look around, you can see innovation of all kinds being developed in all kinds of areas. Here's just an example. In November of 2012, an amendment to the treaty with Mexico on the Colorado River was signed that for the first time in years will guarantee the delivery of some Colorado River water to the Delta on a pilot basis while addressing supply reliability issues for both countries. This is a picture of the signing of Minute 319. So that's an example. Following the basin study, there are interstate working groups that have been convened to start hashing out some of the problems that were identified in that study. Groundwater management has actually been an area of innovation around the United States West compared to other places in the world. Arizona itself has been an innovator over time. For example, the Groundwater Management Act of 1980. And more recently, in specific local areas, people are trying different things. Some examples of local, sort of local initiatives that have been tried or implemented in Arizona that specifically address water use and that the groundwater pumping issue include conservation practices, kind of unique zoning regulations. An idea for a district in the San Pedro was created, although then it was passed by the legislature, but then not by the local residents of that area. Mandatory adequacy jurisdictions are places where you can vote to make those adequate water supply the adequate water supply program that I described as the consumer protection standard, you can vote to make that more mandatory in your area. The law was designed to keep changing, and it does. So innovations and solutions are out there, but given where we are and where at least I believe we need to go, there's a lot to be done. We won't go there quite yet. In Arizona, I'll say frankly that there's something of a tradition of not always discussing water challenges openly or only doing so in very, very small rooms, almost as if that will make them go away. And in part because there's concern about saying the sky is falling when the problems are a lot more complicated than that, and while they're urgent, they're also long-term and multifaceted. But from my perspective, these issues are central enough to our life here and our future that they need to receive a much higher profile. Among the general public, for the most part, people don't know that these issues are out there. These are some generalities that I've just gleaned from my experience in my last few jobs. I've had the privilege of getting to sit in on focus groups and see a bunch of polling and other information about what people know and think about water. And some of my takeaways are that Arizonans don't know a lot about the situation. For example, if you sit in focus groups, you hear lots of them talking about dry riverbeds and saying that those are just the natural state of things in the desert, and kind of don't know that there's a difference between some instances where that's true and others where we've changed a river to make it dry. They see that water issues are long-term, and so they sort of, the general public struggles with the same things that a lot of water professionals do, that it's a long-term issue and yet it's a really important issue. How do you engage with that? They have a hard time engaging with the issues personally, and it's hard to know who to trust about a water issue, and it's hard to know how to engage. But at the same time, people believe that these issues matter, and that preserving supplies and rivers and quality of life for future generations matters. I've been surprised that actually people often care more when you frame something in terms of future generations than in their own self-interest, at least in public opinion research. EDF, my former employer, just did a poll that shows that long-term water issues are kind of in the top five issues for Arizonans, coming, I think, just right after jobs and above crime and concern about state spending, for example. So I guess I'm going to leave you with, I want to leave you with the understanding that the future, not just of the Verde River, but of rivers throughout Arizona, and in fact throughout the West, is not certain and it's not secure. And nor, frankly, is the future reliability and sustainability of our water supplies. We are, in many instances, living on borrowed water. These are challenging, complicated, and region-wide issues. The effects, in some cases, are being felt today, for example, where there are conflicts among water users already. And in some cases won't be felt till the future. But in many, many cases, there are problems where once the effects actually are felt, they'll be very difficult to solve because of the reliance that's been built on the system that's being created now. So this can be discouraging, and I think to some extent it is discouraging. From my point of view, it also means that these problems are very much worth the hard work that they're going to take to solve. Being part of finding a solution on the Verde is being part of finding a solution for our region and for our time, and is even part of the larger issue beyond just our region and our time, of working to make choices for ourselves that we can be proud of, and that leave ourselves and people who come after the kinds of places and opportunities that we want to persist so that we can live and enjoy and learn in and from them. And I don't know about you, but I want my kids, if I have them, and if not, my friends' kids and my sister's kids, to live in a world where there are rivers and where they can choose to learn about them and explore them, maybe come to love them, but at least to live in a world where the kind of richness that a river is and supports is something that's in existence, it's part of the world that they know, and it's something that the society that they live in has taken steps to value and to preserve. So thanks for the work that you do here as the Verde River Basin Partnership. You have a challenging but timely and very important mission. Thanks.